Tiffany Heaven Daniels was just 25 years old when she went missing from Pensacola, Florida on August 12th of 2013 around 5 p.m. Tiffany is a bright young woman who is free-spirited. Every Saturday night, Tiffany could be found swing dancing. She said, quote, "I really, really love to dance. Swing dancing is where I got started back in high school." Before her disappearance, Tiffany posted on her couch surfing page, quote, "Today at the beach, I came to the conclusion that it is good to bring something like a frisbee, two paddles and a ball, etc., with you when you're heading to the beach. Even if you don't speak the same language with someone, frisbee has its own." In her free time, Tiffany said she enjoyed biking, making pottery, figure drawing, fixing things that are ripped or broken, and spending time with things that are naturally green. The previous month before her disappearance, Tiffany posted a Craigslist ad searching for a new roommate. A 53-year-old man named Gary Nichols responded, and Tiffany delightfully agreed to let him move in. Tiffany was thrilled with the idea of having an older, more mature roommate who could help with all of the bills and actually pay on time. Tiffany's mother, Cindy, said, quote, "We didn't feel comfortable with it because we thought it would be kind of odd." Gary Nichols and Tiffany had a lot in common, and they both got along really well. At the time, Tiffany was dating a man named Gray Thomas. He was accepted into a program at the University of Austin in Texas, and he begged Tiffany to move with him. Tiffany had contemplated it, but ultimately decided that she wanted to stay in Pensacola. Her mother, Cindy, said, quote, "I think she wanted to be with Gray, but I don't think she wanted to move. It was so funny because she was always wanting to go travel and do this and do that. Yet when it came down to actually moving, she put her feet down and said, 'No, I'm not moving. I'm not leaving.'" Tiffany and Gray decided to give a long-distance relationship a shot, which helped ease the pain of separating. Gray left the morning of August 11th after having breakfast at Tiffany's house. One important note about Tiffany is that it wasn't uncommon for her to take off on her own. She would simply take off on adventures on a whim, but she did usually come back and someone knew where she was. On the morning of August 12th, when Tiffany went missing, her roommate Gary stated he was awakened by strange sounds between 3 and 5 a.m. He described the sounds as the front door opening and closing multiple times. He went back to sleep not thinking anything of it. He left for work around 7 a.m. and stated that Tiffany's car was gone. Tiffany's father said in an interview that she was not an early riser. If she had class at 7 a.m., she would leave 5 minutes until or right at 7 o'clock. She was normally at work by 8 a.m. This makes Gary's statements about the noises he heard in the early morning hours odd, but it could be a one-off. Tiffany was last seen leaving her job as a theater technician at Pensacola State College around 5 p.m. She asked her supervisor named Bob if she could leave work early and told him that she would possibly not be coming into work for a few days as she had some things going on that she needed to take care of. She did not specify what those things were. Tiffany did not have any conversations with friends or family about her taking leave from work. She also did not have any travel plans that anyone close to her was aware of. Cindy stated Bob was the only person who had knowledge that Tiffany was planning to have time off. Bob was later uncooperative with police and did not give much information. Cindy stated that Bob played a larger role in Tiffany's choice not to move to Austin because he told her that there was not a large art community there. There are allegations that Bob was known for fraternizing with students. Tiffany's sister alluded that she may have engaged in romantic situations with her supervisor in the past. Tiffany clocked out at 4:43 p.m., walked out, and was never seen again. Gary went to sleep, and when he awoke the next morning, he realized Tiffany was not home. He called her cell phone several more times, but was unable to reach her. When he returned from work, he found that the power to the house was cut off. Gary realized the power company cut the power because the bill was not paid, which was out of character for Tiffany. Gary called his daughter Noelle, who is friends with Tiffany, and asked that she get in touch with her family to let them know what was going on. Cindy was notified on Saturday, August 17th, about the situation from Noelle. She received a Facebook message from Noelle, so Cindy decided to call Tiffany and left her a voicemail thinking she was just out on an adventure. Cindy and Noelle made plans to find Tiffany by reaching out to all of her friends through calls and Facebook messages. No one had seen or heard from Tiffany in days. Cindy called Bob, and for the first time, she was informed that Tiffany had not been at work because she had requested time off. She said, quote, "I know that she had a lot on her mind that week, and she had told her boss she might not be able to come in for the rest of the week because she had had some things she needed to take care of. That? We don't know what that was all about." Cindy then filed a missing persons report. Again, Tiffany was known to travel and do things spur of the moment, but always told someone where she was. The sheriff's department wasn't overly concerned due to her previous adventures, and Cindy felt she wasn't taken seriously, but she filed the report anyway. The next day, Detective Harnett gained access to the home where Tiffany lived. He found nothing out of the ordinary, but also didn't find anything that would suggest that Tiffany had planned to leave. Detective Harnett asked Tiffany's boyfriend, Gray Thomas, to go to the local police department in Austin to submit a DNA test. Gray willingly went. He stated that he spoke with Tiffany the day before he left, and the phone records backed up his statements. Gray was ruled out as a suspect based on the evidence that was provided. Gary Nichols was one of the last people to see Tiffany alive. Detective Harnett also felt it was a little strange that Gary would be living with his daughter's friend, especially considering the age gap. Authorities combed through Tiffany's laptop and found evidence that she had browsed the web between 5 p.m. and 7 p.m. Gary stated he left for work at 4 p.m. the day that Tiffany disappeared. If Tiffany came home, Gary said he wouldn't have known because he was on his phone with his girlfriend. One problem with Gary's story is that there is a section of wall missing in Tiffany's closet which connects to Gary's room. Gary contradicts his statement when later he says he was not home, when they believe that Tiffany may have been there. Gary submitted fingerprints and DNA willingly. He was very cooperative throughout the investigation with the investigators. Police later ruled Gary out as a suspect. Tiffany's gray 1999 Toyota 4Runner was found on Pensacola Beach in the west parking lot off of Fort Pickens Road. Her bicycle, purse, and cell phone were still inside the vehicle. A tourist of the area called the local police and reported he saw a man exiting the gray 4Runner. Unfortunately, police were unable to identify the mystery man. There was a fingerprint located on the handle of the driver's side door, as well as on the steering wheel, which did not match Tiffany or anyone in the police database, and they were unable to identify who it belonged to. Authorities were able to determine that Tiffany's vehicle entered the beach at 7:51 p.m. on August 12th, but investigators are unable to determine who was driving because the cameras only capture the license plates of cars that come through the Bob Sykes toll bridge. There are a few theories associated with Tiffany Daniels' disappearance. Her family strongly believes that she may have fallen victim to sex trafficking. Pensacola is situated along I-10, which is a known interstate for sex trafficking. The theory could very well hold water, as another local woman named Shauna Newell was taken from Pensacola, Florida by sex traffickers. Thankfully, in Shauna's case, she was found alive, which brings hope that maybe Tiffany will be too. There was a report out of Metairie, Louisiana that appeared to be legitimate. A waitress at Mr. Ed's claimed that a woman who looked strikingly like Tiffany came in with another young woman and an older Hispanic woman. The waitress claimed that neither of the young women would make eye contact with her. She also stated they both appeared to either be shy or frightened. The one who looked like Tiffany asked if one of the seafood dishes was made with fish or chicken broth. This is an interesting statement because Tiffany is a vegetarian and had asked a similar question to a waiter while out to eat with her mother, Cindy. The waitress allegedly made a comment about how much the girl looked like Tiffany Daniels, and when she came back to the table, the Hispanic woman asked for to-go boxes, and the three promptly left the restaurant. The incident occurred on December 7, 2013, but wasn't reported until January 14, 2014. By the time it was reported, the security footage was filmed over and there was no trace of the trio. Another theory is that Tiffany may have simply gone out for a swim and was swept away by the rip current, which can be quite powerful in the Gulf of Mexico. If this is the case, her body may never be found. Some web sleuthers think that Tiffany may have fallen victim to a homicide. Some believe that her supervisor Bob may have been involved, while others believe it may have been her roommate Gary Nichols or her boyfriend Gray Thomas. Without enough evidence, there is hope that we can cling to, that Tiffany is still out there somewhere, and that she will come home safely. If you have any information regarding the disappearance of Tiffany Heaven Daniels, please contact the Escambia County Sheriff's Office at 850-436-9630.